Yeah, it's gonna get cut. It's gonna get cut at the end. You can't be eating cake while he's telling us jokes.
Cut the cake!
Actually, I had a bunch of stories to share, but then earlier today, Tatiana reminded me that next week is also the 100-year anniversary of the birth of Dizzy Gillespie. And so I thought that instead of telling the story, which I know plenty, I could share one about our Indian-looking lady.
Indian non-looking lady.
Actually, let me tell you that first. The two Indian men are sitting in privacy of their house, and they were talking about their servants. So one told the other one, "Oh, I have the most stupid servant in the whole world." The other one said, "No, mine is more stupid than yours." So they got in conversation about this, so they decided to test them. So the first Indian called his servant. The servant came in, so he told the servant, "I want you to go take this $5 and go to the market and buy me a nice looking Mercedes Benz and come back quick." The servant took the $5 and he left. Then the second one called his servant and he said, "I want you to go to my club and find out if I'm there or not." So that they were testing them. And then the two servants left. In the hallway, the two of them got in conversation. So the first one said, "Can you imagine, my master, give me $5 to go and buy me Mercedes Benz. He doesn't tell me what color. He doesn't tell me what year. How can I decide what kind of car I should get?" The other one said, "Oh, mine is even sillier than yours." So how come? So he asked me to go to his club and find out if he's there or not. "Why don't you call up?" So she reminded me. Of the Indian masters. She has that look, very, very charm and very profound. Well, let me talk about Dizzy Gillespie. I knew Dizzy Gillespie very well, actually. It's amazing that for two reasons. First, I was involved in running a school in Harlem called Harlem Prep, which was a private school. It was basically, Gilbert knows about them, some others. It was a school that prepared the kids for college, mostly were the high school dropout, and they would stay with us for 1 year, and often we placed them in the best colleges and universities around the world, or around the country at least. And Dizzy Gillespie and many other musicians and talented folks were very fond of us, and they often would give a concert and come to school and try to be a model for our students. So that's how I met Dizzy numerous times when he used to come to Harlem Prep. Then at the same time, of course, he was a Baha'i, and I knew him through the fireside and through the activities, and I would invite him, because I was a treasurer of New York Baha'i Assembly, to give concert for the Baha'i Fund. And he gave a number of concerts for Baha'i Fund, and it was tremendous. We raised thousands of dollars to even buy this Baha'i Center. And this is how my relation with him started. But let me tell you how he became a Baha'i. This is quite interesting. Dizzy was very popular, you know, 50s, 60s, and this wonderful woman, a white woman, but named Beth McKenzie. Her story is in the Baha'i news and all over the place. She became very fond of this man, and she decided to teach him the faith. So wherever Dizzy had the concert, she would try to attend the concert and try to give him the message. Of course, Dizzy was polite enough to greet him, but he never really was that interested in the Baha'i faith or anything like that. And actually, he used to say that in the 1960s, it was very dangerous to be chased by a white woman. Because, you know, 60s, I don't know, many of you folks don't remember, was a dangerous time for the white and black man and woman to get together. He said you could either get killed by your wife, if not, you could get killed by the Ku Klux Klan. So this was the situation that he was facing. But then eventually, sometime I think 60, Mike Mungo knows more than exactly year. In 66. Milwaukee, 1966, in the city of Milwaukee, he was giving a concert, and Bette McCanty met him along with her husband. And she insisted to give him a book. And the book that she gave him was Thief of the Night. How many of you know that book? Probably a few of you. It's a wonderful book written by William Sears. Dizzy read that book, and after a few days, he decided to become Baha'i. And then he found out that the author of the book, William Sears, is in Los Angeles, and at that time he was giving some concert in San Francisco. He decided to go there and visit him. And he stayed with William Sears for a few days, and really those few days confirmed his faith. And he became such a dedicated Baha'i that you won't believe that. He, you know, sometimes when you see him on stage, or these days if you see his videos, he may act silly and he acts funny, but he was extremely deeply faithful Baha'i. And we knew that from his, he was instrumental of giving message to Jimmy Carter for the first time, and numerous other politicians and the board leader. Right after he became Baha'i, he decided to change even the name of his band. He decided to call it United Nation Band, because he had black, white, and some Spanish member of his band. And the State Department asked him to take his band and travel around the world. And it's so interesting that many years later I found out he came to my city in Persia, which is very unusual when I talk about my relation with Dizzy Gillespie. There's a city in Iran called Abadan, which is in the southern part of Persia. And I saw some picture of Dizzy giving concert in the city of Abadan when I was, I think, a young fellow, a teenager, or even younger. And his pictures are in the, if you Google him, you would see his face all over the place in some theater in the city of Abadan. And let me tell you a few stories about him, that my own recollection. He came to New York, and he was giving performance in New York. At the same time, Pandavakas Olinga, which was an African Baha'i who had the highest title in the Baha'i faith, they called him the Hand of a Cause of Baha'u'llah. He was in town, so I picked him up, the Olinga, in the airport. And as we were driving to the city, he asked me if there is any way that he could meet Dizzy Gillespie. Because he said, I know him, I have met him a couple of times in Africa, and I'd love to see him. I said, okay, even though his wife gave me a hard time every time I call him, but let me try. So I called his wife, she always answered the phone. Ah, he said, you again? So I said, yes, me again. Is there any way I can talk to John? His real name was John, we would call him Dizzy. He said, yeah, here. He gave me the phone and he said, John, Mr. Lingo is here and love to see you. Is there any way we could make some arrangement? So he said, of course, I love Olinga, this and that. Tonight, I'm performing in a club in Harlem called Club Baron. Is it still there or not? Probably not. It was a huge, big club in Harlem in the 60s and 70s. Big band used to play there. So bring him over. So Olinga gave a talk at the UN church, which is right across the United Nations. And then after that, a few Baha'is, including myself, we got in the car, we drove to Harlem, and we entered the club. And from a door when we entered, I waved my hand, so Dizzy, who was on stage, realized that we are here. And he waved back and started to smile, and he stopped the concert music, and he said, the conqueror of Africa, the way you should see the way Dizzy talked. Olinga is here, my brother, and I have written a piece of music in his honor called Olinga. We're going to play that as he is going to his table, because he has made an arrangement for a special table for us to sit down. So as they were playing the song of the piece Olinga, we walked toward the table, and most of the people there were half drunk. Most of them 100% drunk. And they keep getting out, hi brother, give me five. Give me a hug and this. So eventually we got to our table, it was six, seven of us. Within a few minutes, the table was full of scotch and vodka, bottles and bottles. All these people, it's a tradition in old days, at least I don't know anymore, that when you have an honored guest in a club, different people would send a bottle of whiskey or cognac, whatever. My God, and they said, commissioner of souls sent this, commissioner of that, this and that. So I got so scared that somebody's going to take a picture of me and hand over cards with all these booze. I'm in trouble. Definitely I will lose my boat tonight. That he took the hand of a cars to a club and he got him drunk. And they, you know, Baha'is believe all kind of stuff. So quickly I told the waiter, please take this bottle away right away. And he was surprised. Why? I said, take it away quick. Give us some ginger ale and club soda or diet coke. So he brought us. Oh, we had such a good time that night with Olingo. And there's some picture I put on Facebook a few times. Was in that club. That was one incident that is so clear in my mind. The other occasion was Dizzy or John was playing in a club in south of France. And I think, who was the king those days? Reiner? Prince Reiner? Whoever was the king, I don't know. Prince Reiner was opening his night as a concert, and the Shah of Iran was present that night, and then Dizzy was performing. It happened that the Shah or King of Persia, his doctor was a Baha'i, General Alai, not Ayadi. And this is the story that he remembered, and he told me personally, and I remember clearly. He said the manager of the hotel, after Dizzy performed, he brought him to the Shah's table and introduced him. And he said, okay, His Majesty, the Shah of Iran, this is Dizzy Gillespie, one of the best musicians in the world. So they shake hands. So the Shah asked him, do you know anything about my country? You know, they talk like this when you're a king. And he said, yes, of course. That's where Baha'u'llah came from. You should see this, the expression on the Shah's face in front of all these few ministers and others who were there, and he saw him that day. And then he turned to his ayati, who knew he was Baha'i, he said, can you imagine this black guy with the broken horn? You know, his horn was always twisted. Is a Baha'i? And this was quite an interesting thing. What else I can tell you? Oh, I have lots of stories about Dizzy. He was here actually, this very same room. He would give a concert for us. There's a high school close by called PS 41 on the other side of the 6th Avenue. It has a huge gymnasium. He would give a concert there, and we would arrange to have a reception for Dizzy and the other musicians here. And there was a bunch of Persian ladies who bring Persian food. He loves Persian food. And he always called me Brother Hussein. So he would come there and eat the food and all that. And you know, they have named the auditorium in his honor. And we have his pictures there. I think between Dizzy Gillespie and Sins and Kraft, they were the most outspoken Baha'i musician that have really taught the faith so extensively in this country. And we are grateful to people like that. Okay, next time I tell you some stories, I promise. Thank you. Thank you.